Here we go. This is the amazing people I already said, and I'll just highlight Kirsten Jung again, poster number 3. And please stop me if something else happens. Thank you for that. The origin story for why we're interested in water comes from actually another professor at Northwestern, Sarah Young, who works in the area of water insecurity. And these are some photos of her research highlighting some of the issues that many around the globe face with kind of access to clean water. Often faced with the decision of going to a relatively local source, but maybe of questionable quality, or spending additional time, resources, you know, transportation and so on and so forth, to go to a cleaner source, but that might be farther away. And part of the issue here is it's kind of hard to assess water quality, so it's hard to make the right decisions in that case. It is a absolutely fundamental question for many of us. Those images were particularly striking. I think many in the kind of Western world take water quality for granted, but it is absolutely important to almost everything we do in our lives. But quality is challenging to assess because we can't see or taste the contaminants that can be present even at low levels that are harmful. It's also a global issue. I think the estimate is about 2 billion people on the planet lack sufficient access to safe and clean water. So there's major potential to impact lives for the positive here. And the United Nations has identified this as one of the major sustainable development goals to work towards. If you look at the contaminants that are of global concern, these are the top 3, E. coli, fluoride, and arsenic. But if you dig under the hood at other lists, this one is from the US EPA, it lists a whole range of compounds that are regulated and even many more that are not regulated. And I think what is striking here is that it's a really complex problem to try to figure out how you're gonna measure all of these different things to assess water quality. But it does beg the question, shouldn't we all know what is in our water to be able to make healthy decisions? It's not like you can't monitor this. This is laboratory equipment, molecular biology or analytical chemistry equipment that can get down to very sensitive detection levels. But if you kind of break it down, it's basically, they're complicated to operate. They're expensive to operate. And as a result, the model for using this is laboratory based. They sit into a laboratory. You collect samples. There's logistics of sending and receiving information and samples and so on and so forth. And as a result, the technologies aren't really scaling to the global level that they're needed. The whole point of trying to go after this is to say, can we use the power of biology, synthetic biology, to make water quality monitoring accessible for all? So I think I don't need to go into too many of the details of the concepts here. I think everyone is pretty familiar. The idea is that there are natural biosensors, RNAs or proteins found in cells. We want to extract them and repurpose them for our own uses. We'll rewire them. They often control gene expression processes. We'll rewire them to produce, nice, easily detectable outputs in terms of reporter genes. And then we'll re-engineer them, in this case, to work in a cell-free environment because it's much easier to deploy. You can assemble the reactions, freeze-dry them, and then rehydrate them at the point of use to be able to assess water quality. So this is the vision, and there's a few needs here. There's modularity. You want to be able to sense a lot of different things. Specificity and sensitivity. You need to want to be able to detect what you think you're detecting at the levels that you need to detect them at. And then different things need to be put together for them to be actually used in the field. And I'll touch on all of these in order. So in terms of modularity, when we started off, we wanted to design a system that is as simple as possible that can use the breadth of what's available in nature. And here we can use RNA biosensors such as riboswitches that bind to small ligands and alter gene expression outcome. In this case, we'll be interested in transcriptional outcomes. Allosteric transcription factor proteins, on the other hand, use a protein-DNA interaction at a specific operator site on the DNA to basically gate downstream transcription. We then need to combine this with a different output, and here we're interested in both protein outputs, maybe enzymes or GFP, enzymes that can produce colorimetric compounds, or fluorescent RNAs, for example, to remove the translation step. And then we need to drive this with some RNA polymerase. Here we can use native bacterial polymerases or phage polymerases to speed reactions up. And then, of course, we'll also be interested in using circuits to enhance or improve the platform. To start off, we actually, in the lab, a whole other part of the lab works on structural biology, dynamic RNA folding, and we were working on a riboswitch that senses the fluoride anion. And here we were able to use our knowledge of how that worked and rewire it to control the expression of a colorimetric reporter protein. And fluoride was a nice bridge to this work because it is of major concern around the globe. At high levels, it interferes with bone and joint development. What the nice thing about this, we put this in a cell-free system here, both transcription and translation from bacterial lysate. You can see that this riboswitch naturally senses at the level of about 0.1 millimolar, which is about 2 parts per million sodium fluoride, which is the US EPA toxicity limit. So that was really nice. We almost got it for free. And in this case, we're producing a kind of a faint yellow color in about 60 minutes. You can see that by eye. We wanted to expand, though, beyond RNA biosensors, and there's plenty of riboswitches, but not many of them are detecting water contaminants of concern. But there's many proteins, transcription factors, that cells use to do just that. And this gave us an opportunity to turn a couple of different knobs here. One is we replaced the protein output with a fluorescent RNA, so we only had to transcribe and not translate, hopefully speeding up the reaction. And the other is we can use a fast phage RNA polymerase, the T7 polymerase, which can speed things up even more. And this is just showing you kind of the mechanism, the cartoon mechanism here, using the tetracycline receptor binding to its operator site. It's basically going to gate transcription. So when it's bound in the absence of ligand, transcription is blocked. When ligand binds to the protein, it unbinds and allows transcription. This is the type of data that we get. These are essentially, there's no background subtraction or anything in this data. The only thing we've done is calibrate the fluorescence measurement to a FITC standard, which is shown on the left. And a level of about 0.5 micromolar FITC is what's detectable by eye. Here showing these different curves that with different amount of ligand. So without any ligand, we get very little fluorescence, almost no leak. And then you see a nice sharp transition there. And if I just draw a line at the end and plot a little dose response curve, you can see that nice the trend there. We built a little 3D hand-printed illuminators. I hope this video is showing up for everybody, but you can't quite see it. There's one tube that's going to glow green, and in about 15 minutes, it's a simple blue LED thing that we can build for several dollars to try to really make this fluorescent readout accessible. And since, you know, everybody needs a great acronym, we wanted some more women scientists out there. We named this ROSLIN for RNA output sensors activated by ligand induction. And this is actually an image of Rosalind Franklin generated with ROSLIN reactions on a couple of different 384 well plates. This kind of nicely shows some of the tunability here. Here we're just changing DNA template concentration to get different outputs there. The nice thing about the platform is if you want to change what you sense, you can change the protein and the DNA operator. Here's just showing an array of different ones, sensing things like antibiotics, tetracyclines, and macrolides, two of the most commonly used classes, some small molecules, things coming from household cleaning products to different cosmetic products. And on the bottom, most interest, especially in the U.S., is metals, things like lead and copper, which are heavily regulated and are major issues as kind of infrastructure decays. On a kind of a personal note, when we were developing this potential impact, Kirsten had come up with a copper sensor, and shortly thereafter, there was a bunch of articles about how the Detroit public school system shut off all of the water fountains because of concern of copper and lead contamination. So I got a little paranoid and wanted to test my own house. And so I ordered one of these kits that I just showed you online. And I don't know if you can quite see on this calendar is kind of when I ordered the test, when I received these tubes, I filled them with water, sent them back when they reached the testing facility. And then I got the results. It was about a month to see that the water was safe to drink. But these sensors, even in kind of the version 1.0 or whatever, are giving time to results in about 40 minutes in this case. So it's a dramatic speed up. So potentially pretty promising there. Just as a side note, if if you don't have a transcription factor that senses what you want to, in collaboration with the Jewett lab, we've been trying to figure out how you can then couple to different enzymatic cascades that might break down the compound that you care about into something that you can. Here's a nice example of a three enzyme cascade that breaks down atrazine, which is a harmful herbicide, into cyanuric acid, which can be sensed directly by a transcription factor. And so this is just kind of a nice thread that we think there's a lot of potential here for expanding the capabilities, and could be interesting to think about from a synthetic cell perspective as well. Specificity is an important concern. You want to be able to know that you're sensing what you think you are. In this case, Kirsten set up a nice matrix of Roslyn reactions showing a bunch of different transcription factors on the left and different compounds on the top. And you can see, by and large, the matrix looks pretty good, except for there's one matrix element down at the bottom where the copper sensor, CSOR, is actually sensitive to zinc. And this is something that happens a lot in metal sensing transcription factors, and obviously is undesirable. What's pretty cool, though, is that the zinc sensor, SMIT-B, is not sensitive to copper. And this makes a nice use case for all this logic that we've been playing around with. And so we wanted to ask, okay, rather than solving this with a protein engineering strategy, can we solve it with circuits? And here we're really inspired by Elisa Franco's lab, who had developed a nice RNA molecule called a kleptomer. They called it kleptomer, which basically can bind to broccoli and inhibits its signal. And so here we can combine two different transcription factors, the copper sensor and the zinc sensor, and wire them up into a NMP ligate such that if zinc is present, the signal is canceled. And it turns out to work remarkably well and kind of fixes that matrix element. So that's kind of a nice little proof of concept that circuits can do cool things in these reactions. Sensitivity is also really important. These are the dose response curves for everything that are reporting. Most of these transcription factors are in the kind of micromolar range. And depending on the compound and what's toxic, that can be good enough. They can actually be too sensitive, or in quite a few cases, not sensitive enough. What's cool about the cell-free system, as opposed to kind of wholesale biosensors, is you can tune some of these dose response curves by changing molecular concentration. So on the left, we actually have to desensitize the copper sensor, and we can do that by adding more transcription factor. And on the right, we can you can do the same thing. We need to sensitize the lead sensor by decreasing the amount of transcription factor, although you'll notice that the leak increases in that case, which is kind of a trade-off there, not so desirable. We were trying to think of other strategies besides just simple tuning, and again went back to circuits. And what was cool is that the Seuss lab in Darmstadt had come up with another aptamer. This time it's an anti-TET-R aptamer that actually, when it is present, will bind to the TET-R protein and enable it to de-repress a DNA template. And so we thought we could just wire up a simple feedback circuit where the TET-R is not only gating the expression of the output, but also its own repressor. And when we do this, in fact, we do get a nice little shift in the dose response curve, in this case for tetracycline sensing. And the nice thing about this strategy is that aptamers that bind proteins are some of the more readily evolved in the lab, and we hope that this might be a general strategy to sensitize a range of transcription factors. But to the real point of this conference, you know, can we do more with circuits? I think this is where a lot of the very interesting questions arise. And to me, it's something I've always been inspired by. I think Tom really illustrated this nicely in the introduction, that where the field has gotten with DNA strand displacement circuits is quite amazing. So, you know, starting from, you know, these logic gate type things shown on the left with Georg's work, all the way up to what I still kind of blows my mind, Lulu's very sophisticated computational architecture that can compute some pretty cool functions. And one of the things we're thinking about now is what functions might be most useful in a diagnostic context. This has always been a goal, to try to figure out how to make this work with our systems. And so Kirsten's been launching on trying to make this interface. And we just put a preprint up on this so we could tell you all today. The idea is that the previous version I just told you directly couples the sensory layer of the transcription factors to this output layer, in this case, the broccoli fluorescent aptamer. But the question is, can we instead create an intermediate signal processing layer in between the sensory layer, and then use strand displacement for that as well as the signal output. This is not a new idea, and it's not a particular, it's relatively simple looking idea. We should be able to just put the gates in there and it should be good. We had a hard time pulling it off. And so just a couple little tips and tricks. As we thought about how to do this, this is what we had on the left, our previous scheme. What we want to do is essentially replace the broccoli with another RNA molecule. Here we're calling it invade R, because it's eventually going to be able to be programmed to invade a DNA duplex here with the typical fluorophore quencher labeling, so that once the invade R invades this duplex, it peels off the quencher to generate the fluorescent signal. A couple of things happened right away. We were using 3' toll holds, and as many have discovered, the T7 RNA polymerase molecule will view that as a nonspecific promoter sequence and transcribe it. And Kirsten nicely showed on the bottom left, if you just put a signal gate, the fluorophore quencher, in a reaction with a 3' toll hold and T7 polymerase, you'll get a very bright and robust, very quick signal. And if you run the products out on a gel and chew up all the DNA, you can see RNA side products are generated. Now you can block this with modifications, chemical modifications of the DNA gate, or even more simply, just using a 5' toll hold that goes against the natural polarity of the transcription reaction, and that cleans it up. So it takes out all the background, that's the black line on the bottom left, and there's no RNA side products. So that was great. Now, another interesting challenge arises when you want to interface this now with transcription factors. The way we have configured it, we have the T7 promoter followed by the operator sequence and then invade R. So the operator sequence itself is transcribed. And this can create interference with the RNA structures of invade R. So for example, on the bottom, or on the right side, but the bottom left, you see that for SMIT-O, which is a zinc sensor, its operator sequence is binding into that invade R, predicted to bind into it. And the invade R sequence is highlighted in green there. Now, you can, thankfully, we've got tools like NUPAC and so on and so forth. We can design, insulating structures and sequences so that we kind of sequester that that operator site within a different RNA structure, so that it does not directly overlap the invade R structure. But these are the types of things that we did quite a bit of work to develop design principles around. Now we've got a good scheme for solving some of these challenges. There's also some really interesting things about optimizing the T7 promoter sequence and so on and so forth to speed up transcription and prevent abortive initiation. So there's lots of tricks to do. When we put them all together, you get a pretty good payoff right away in terms of speed alone. So this is comparing the TET-R sensing circuit with the aptamer in green. You're getting about visible signal between 40 and 50 minutes, but with strand displacement, it's about 10 minutes. And so that's really fast reaction and getting to be very usable from a diagnostic standpoint. The other cool thing is we can now finally start to think about really neat circuits that we want to build. And here I think is pretty fascinating in terms of the circuits that we saw. We sought to solve an issue or a request, a feature request. I guess many users or people interested in diagnostics were telling us, and they wanted to know, can these reactions report on concentration? Many of them are kind of, based on the dose response curve, give a yes, no above a certain threshold. And you might be able to detect a little bit about different ligand concentration that goes into the reaction by fluorescent intensity, but it's very hard to do by eye. And so we were inspired to solve this and think about trying to create a circuit that can act like an analog to digital converter. Basically take that analog signal of ligand concentration and convert it into different bits. Here, an array of different tubes, and the user would count which tubes were lit up, and the tubes that were lit up would give some indication about the concentration of the ligand that went into all of those tubes. And to implement this, we thought about a simple thresholding reaction. We basically set up identical reactions with a threshold now that will slow the reaction down in proportion to the amount of threshold present in the reaction. And that way, only if you have high levels of ligand concentration will you be able to consume the threshold in a in a given amount of time. The amazing thing about strand displacement that we all know that really enables this is you can tune these the kinetics of strand displacement by changing the toe hold. And so in this case, we use a 4-nucleotide toe hold for the signal generation part and an 8-nucleotide toe hold for our threshold. And we put different amounts of that in there. And what's also amazing, I think, is something not to take lightly, is how predictable these systems are. So by just putting some simple ODEs together and pulling parameters directly from the toe hold strand displacement literature, a little bit about T7 transcription and so on and so forth, we were able to get simulations that basically very accurately predicted the function of the real thing. So that helped us figure out, you know, things like how much template concentration do we put in to make the system work. And when we did it, we put it together, and Kirsten tried this out, and indeed, this is working as designed. You've got an array of 4 tubes here. You put in different zinc concentrations, and the tubes light up according to how much zinc was in there. And so we're getting kind of, you know, rough concentration ranges. I think we're in the, you know, 1 to 2 micromolar precision on that concentration. And so it's a really neat concept, and we're really looking forward to conversations at this conference to figure out how we might build upon these ideas and some of the other things done for strand displacement circuits to build and enhance these systems. I'll just end with some quick notes on field deployment. We've actually taken these out of the lab to a couple places. The first was actually in Costa Rica, where we found a report of high levels of dental fluorosis. We took the fluoride riboswitch sensor there, and Matt Varislav was able to verify that the sensor worked as indicated. And here he just kind of sampled, groundwater, puddles, streams, you name it, and all the positive and negative controls worked, and we were able to find field samples with elevated levels of fluoride on that case. So that was really great. Kirsten and Khaled and I actually took some of the metal sensors of Roslyn to Paradise, California, which was devastated in the 2018 campfire, and you can see some of the pictures there showing, which is why people were very concerned with metal contamination, because you basically melted all the metal in the entire town. We actually found some failure modes in terms of the cryopreservation of these reactions that we were able to fix with different packaging. And when we did that, we sent them out to our collaborator, Sandrine Matusek, and she was able to show that field samples of municipal water in Paradise, California worked as desired with both with the copper and zinc sensors and that NIMPLY circuit. So the kind of conclusion here is in this table of water sensing techniques, we're hoping we can start to really add a couple of rows to this in terms of really simplifying the technology and driving down the cost and making it so that people can monitor water at the point of need or point of use. So lots of fascinating work to continue, and we really hope nucleic acid technologies are going to be a major component of these going forward. A lot of amazing people to thank in addition to the ones I already did. And I just wanted to end by saying Kirsten, as poster number 3, has a lot of great details, especially on the strand displacement things that are relatively new. And her screen name is shown there because hard to change the name in Teams, but hopefully you can find her and strike up a convo, and very interested in talking more. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So thank you to the speakers. We are bang on time. I suggest that as usual, we move to the separate rooms where we can discuss and ask questions to the 2 speakers of this session. See you there.
Guy, are you going to go to 1 and I'll go to 2?
Yep.